Welcome to this Q&A of Last Days of Summer, which is part of the 31st edition of Nordisk Panorama this year. The film is not only nominated for the New Nordic Voice, but of course it's also participating in the Audience Award, so please do not forget to vote after this session. My name is Martijn Te Pas, and together with Cecilia Lidin, I'm one of the programmers of the festival this year, and I'll be the host for this Q&A. And I have the great pleasure to be talking to Carl Fries Forkhammer. How are you doing, Carl?
I'm good. Yeah. It's good. Yeah. Great to be here.
Well, really nice to have you here. I guess most people don't really know you that well. Can you maybe just please tell the audience a bit about yourself, about where you studied film, etc.?
Yeah, sure. I'm Danish, but I'm kind of but I studied a lot in other countries. So I went to Czech Republic and studied there for a year, and then and that's where I met one of the protagonists of this film. How I got connected into this film, and then last year I graduated from National Film and Television School in UK. But I also had a lot of mentoring from a Danish film director here called Max Kistner. So I learned some of the kind of Danish documentary tradition, kind of mixed with both Central European and UK. So I'm a little bit of a mix in that sense. But I'm mostly, I think I also have a great connection with the Danish documentary tradition.
Yeah, of course. Well, we'll talk about that for a bit because it's a wonderful mix. To me, it seems a bit different from the Danish tradition in the sense that it's wonderfully loose and impressionistic and jazzy. It has so many moods and colors, this film. Could you tell us a bit about the short film, Ravens, that you made before this and was premiered in Vision du Réel last year? And it's basically this long film is a new cut or a new version. Can you just tell us a bit about that?
Yeah. Basically, Ravens was my graduation film. I had a project in, we were doing another film in UK, which in the film school, we had a school project before this, which was kind of a little bit tough and a little bit personal, and it was a rough way. So I was thinking for my graduation film, I thought, okay, I'm gonna do, this is gonna be my last film at film school, so I'm gonna have a great time because this is like something that I'm gonna leave with. And I think it's important that when you leave film school, you leave with a good taste in your mouth because it might be a while before you get funding for your next project. So I just remembered my one of my best friends who I met in Czech Republic, who was studying at the theater school, Tamara. She was always telling me about her love. She was always calling me and saying like, Carl, when will I meet this great love of my life? Yeah. You know, and then one day she called me and said, Carl, I met this guy and he's really good. He's really Catholic. He doesn't really, he's like, he doesn't want to sex that much, but I really like him. He's very different than all my friends, but I really like him. And then at the same time, some of the other friends that I met, one of the other couples were going through a patch. So I thought, okay, going to Warsaw and making a love story there, that sounds like, the most fun project I could do. So I went there and then I filmed some scenes to see if it worked out, because every time I went to Warsaw, my experience was that every time I would go to Warsaw, they would be like, I hate you, I love you. Or like it would have a big fight and then they would become friends again. You know, it was straight out, and they would always talk about how they felt in a way, they were very good at putting words on their emotions. They were extremely generous with and extremely honest. I think I feel like that's a great trait of the Central European. This is for some, in some places, not everyone is like that. It's of course a specific environment, but I went there and then I filmed Tamara and I filmed some scenes, And I caught it and I thought, okay, that I could see there was a film there. So I went and I filmed that and I started filming the second part of the story with the guy Shesput. I started filming it there as well. But I couldn't fit his story and Tamara's story together at that point.
Okay. And so you decided later, after you also won a beautiful award, the Griesen Award, a very great award in the UK. You decided later to make that into a longer film, or how did that develop?
Yeah, it was. I really wanted Shesput because I found I mean he's a very good friend, and I really would love to have him in the Tamara film. So it was actually my edit was twice as long because I was trying to fit his film into Tamara's film, but there was a problem with having two stories and his story. When I started filming, it was about him getting his girlfriend back, but then they just got back together immediately. So the story became like a kind of deeper existential crisis, and it was, I couldn't really get it. And then when I made this one, I thought, okay, it's because I need a third story. And then we had Ponek, who was Tamara's friend in Ravens, who was a very, really attractive character and really fantastic person, and I thought, well, okay, if I make it three bits, then it could work. And so I just went back and I filmed actually for a month more, mm-hmm. and worked in Danish reality TV or documentary/reality TV, and then I got some money and I went back and shot for a longer film, because the film in my head was always, I always imagined it as a multi-plot film. But I just couldn't get it to work with Tamara and Shesput, only those two. I needed a third one to kind of, ideally, that my idea was, what I thought would have been really cool was to have these three stories in three different times, but kind of, so you had Tamara's story,
yeah.
and then you had the scenes, and then you saw the other, maybe the same scene, but from another perspective.
Yeah.
So you had three different times, and then like mess with time, so you had the feeling of three timelines, but happening at the same time, and then them coming together in the end. But then Tamara cut her hair, so that's the thing about documentary.
Absolutely. And how did you manage it with the language? Of course, you worked in the Czech Republic for a year. You also, your graduation film there is a beautiful short, but in Czech. Now this is in Polish. Do you speak both languages, or how do you deal with what's being said?
It was kind of like, I think it was, I kind of made it, I think I looked a lot at images and moods. I became like, started to try to sense the mood of a conversation. So you ended up looking more for images and tones. And because I didn't know what was talked about.
Yeah.
I didn't know. I was very, so the process became me being very open about what I was interested in to all the characters. So it became like a collaborative effort. I was very inspired by Italian director Roberto Minervini and how he works with characters, like how he just explains what he's interested in and then makes the thing with them, film with them. It wasn't like that directed as much in this in this sense. It was way more just like an openness and an honesty. And then I had an ally in Tamara, because Tamara is actually a film director, so very talented, very skilled editor and director. And so I kind of always had an ally, and she had this beautiful, I feel it's a kind of Central European thing of having a distance to yourself, where she would always say, she would have a horrible, horrible talk with her boyfriend at that point, and it would be devastating to her. And then afterwards you come, Carl, it was really interesting. Really, it's really interesting what he said. It was really, this is going to be a good scene.
She's sort of also always a sort of meta, from a meta view, watching herself and the scene from a theatrical and cinematic kind of point of view.
She could go in and out of it really quickly, and she was, I think that was kind of, that was such an important part of this. And then I kind of, this process became learning at looking at images, and I think in the end it was also an advantage, because I think like a lot of my friends there that I was filming, they weren't that worried about down the line. They were really thinking about how does it feel right now, and right now it would feel weird if I understood everything they said. but I think they could more relax if they just knew that I didn't understand what they were saying in a way. So I
think you were in a way part of the film very much. In that way, it's a very much of a collaborative effort, it seems. And it's so seamless. That's really wonderful. So, of course, I wanted to also talk how you prepare this film, because it feels like a very adventurous way of making films, just like basically going and being there and then hoping for the best nearly. Is that a fair description, or is there more pre-production involved in research than...
I think you make like a plan A, B, C, D, E, F, G. I think it's like the thing about making something like this is having characters you're really believing in. And then, I mean, because like a part of filmmaking and documentary making is like getting more and more precise, you know, and, you know, getting more precise at what you want to tell, and I'm in my film learning process, so I'm learning that all the time. But there's also an advantage in like having some when you make something like that, having different films. Like, for example, I had Tamara's story, I had Shesput's story. It might be Tamara's story would take over, or Shesput's story could have taken over. It could have been, so like having some contingencies when you make something like this, where it's so up to where you don't have any control, I think that's a measure of control you have in that sense. But it's the most fun and most frustrating way of filmmaking, because it's like sometimes it's sitting for 2 weeks, and they don't and my friends wouldn't have time because they forgot that they had a 70-hour job a week. They were working 70 hours a job, you know, and then they would do it in two bands at the same time. And then but then you would go there and you'd get a scene. Yeah. You would run out in the rain where it was pouring down. You'd have something, some beauty. And then it was like, you went home and it was like, oh, it was totally worth it. It was like.
Yeah. But maybe this style is also defining your authorship. So, maybe in your next films, I'm not sure. It's also good to use this because it's really different, I must say. So that's why we really enjoyed selecting your film.
Ah, thank you. Yeah, I mean, no, I think so. I hope so. I think like I'm trying for my next project. I'm working on something where there's both a measure of where there's something which is filmed like this. Mm-hmm. And then there's an element of it, which is a story that takes place in the past, which has like a measure, like more control. Okay. So because, you know, I'm a young filmmaker, I mean, you're in film school all the time. So yeah. I'm trying to learn that as well. But I hope to keep this in mind. But with that said, like this is kind of like, this film is kind of like a young filmmaker's game in a way. You can do that because you're in your late 20s, you don't have kids, so you can sit in an apartment in Warsaw and wait for 1.5 weeks without shooting something.
Yeah.
So I think that's the challenge. It's like, how do you make this into something when you have a dip? I'm trying to figure out that.
Yeah. It feels also that the film is very musical and rhythmical. So how important for you is music or poetry when making films or preparing for them?
I mean, I think it's like, it's the most fun part in a way. I know your film should work without music, ideally. I mean, like it's always better to sit in and edit and get things to flow without music, but it's the most, I think it's a very, I love going, finding references for music and working in a mood in music. And I think for example, Tamara's film was like a Serge Gainsbourg track. I was listening to La Javanaise all the time because it had this bohemian feel. And I felt like they were living a very bohemian life compared to me and my friends in Copenhagen. And then at the same time, there was this romantic, really romantic. I really think it's one of the most fun parts, trying to find a musical note to bring it together. So I'm starting a playlist when I'm starting to make the films, because that's where you get the sense of like, oh, what should the climax feel like? Or these scenes, yeah. what should your emotional climax feel like? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's full of wonderful music. Also the music that's I think made for the film. Can you say something about that a bit?
Yeah, the music is made by my very good and talented friend Marco Tvelman, who is a pop producer actually, or pop and indie producer who makes kind of and he's extremely talented and really quick at working with references. So this the challenge of this whole soundtrack is made in 3 days altogether, okay. 3 or 4 days. So there's like 15 minutes of music. And that's like, so he's really fast. So with this, I didn't have the we didn't have the luxury of like working, like we hadn't had the luxury of exploring a sound for a long time. What we had was that from Ravens, we had this hum where the main character is humming this old Polish folk song called Lipka Silona. I didn't pronounce this correctly, but. And that moment worked quite well because it was a time where like the music, her inner music connected with the outer world. And we kind of took that and then we developed like a soundtrack from these kind of Polish folk songs in a way.
Okay.
And then we did a theme for Chesput, which were, where we listened to a little Jan Johansson, old Swedish pianist, jazz pianist. And then we thought, took and listened to Polyfolk and tried to mix that together into like a kind of folk soundtrack. And, but it was really, but it happened like this, but in the end, I'm really amazed with the result that we got done. And in the time we had, I thought he did an amazing job.
No, absolutely. We have to wrap up soon. It's between 15 and 20 minutes. I have one question just about the screening. Can you screen this film in Poland? It's full of sex, drugs, rock and roll. How about that?
It's a good question. I would really love to, because I really aim to make I really wanted it to be a Polish film more than a foreigner making a film in Poland. And from what I hear from Polish people who saw it, I think they feel like that. I really love Central European film and I love Central European culture and I really hope that this feels also like a Polish film, so I would really love to show that, but I don't know. Right now I don't have a Polish premiere just yet, so but fingers crossed.
And you can't show it on television in this time, maybe this political climate. Maybe not.
Oh
so
yeah, right now it's I think it's I'm not sure there's a HBO Poland or different platforms that which are international, but it's also an art film, so I'm trying to figure that out, but I'm also producing myself, so it's not moving so fast.
I guess. Okay, super, thanks Carl, and thank you for participating here, and thanks for the audience for watching. And please, there are a lot of other films to enjoy too here at the festival. Don't forget to vote, and see you later, and hopefully later somewhere for real. Thank you, Carl.
Thanks a lot.